Good evening, everybody. At the outset, I would like to thank IMI Kodapakkam for honoring me with this invitation. See, a lot of changes have been happening in the treatment of cancer in the last 2 to 3 decades. And not only in the cancer treatment, the disease as such is changing its trend in the last few decades. So all these things put together, both the changes in the treatment and the trends, we are into a new era where we are looking at a lot of things happening in the next few coming years. Just briefly touch into some of the important changes and the recent advances that is happening in the field of oncology. As far as the cancer trend is changing, traditionally India is a country which has a very low incidence of cancer. In fact, if you look around the global incidence, we are far, far behind the most of the countries. Even among the third world countries, we have one of the lowest incidence of cancer. If we look a little closer, India has nearly about 90 patients of 90 per lakh incidence, whereas the world average is something around 182, which is almost double our incidence. And in developed countries, it is almost 4 times that what we have. But the good news stops there, and our country is undergoing a vast change in the last few years. The trend is actually doubling at a very fast pace. The last one decade, it has nearly for some of the cancers, it has doubled, and for most of the cancers, it is increasing at an alarming rate. And there are only very few cancers that are actually stable or has a declining trend. We are expecting a rate of about 2 times like what we have today in the year coming in 2035. That's pretty fast rate of having. So look at the cancer incidence for breast cancer alone. In 2008, it was nearly about 84,000. Right now, it is something around 1 lakh. And in 2020, we are expecting it to reach 1 lakh 24 per total number of cases. So, and not only that, we have quite a bit of an alarming change compared to the rest of the world. Incidence in India is actually not at the for the elderly patients. We have it something as the middle age group. At 41 to 50 and 50 to 60, which is the most productive part of most of the people. So this is where we are looking at a very alarming situation. As far as our understanding in the treatment and about the cancer biology is concerned, it has rapidly grown in the last few, especially after the Human Genome Projects. Now, we have a very similar, our understanding of molecular pathogenesis and the genetic alterations in various cancers is quite astounding, and we can nearly predict who will develop cancer, who won't develop a cancer, just looking at the genomes. In addition to the histopathological classifications we have, and we routinely know, we have what is the molecular classification right now. Molecular classification was proposed long back, but it was not a reality. But right now, it is a reality for few cancers, especially like breast cancers and colorectal cancers. By looking at the molecular classification, we can precisely prognosticate the survival and decide the treatment on a very individualized basis. As far as the histopathological classification and stage grouping is concerned, it is for a group of people. But looking at the molecular classification, we can customize the treatment and precisely prognosticate the survival. So, as I said, the cancer incidence is growing. One of the reasons why the cancer incidence has become so much is the amount of improvement that we have in radiology, especially the newer modalities like very sophisticated digital mammograms and all virtual colonoscopies and all these things really pick up new small lesions which may have just gone off without causing any trouble in your life. This is one of the reasons for the increased incidence in cancer. In other ways, the improvements in radiology have really resulted in me picking up these cancers quite early in the natural history, where the treatment is most effective. Some of the things I've just put as slides, I'm not going into details about these things. So I'm a little running short of time, so let me just directly move into the advances in the management strategies. See, all, we can say the cancer treatment, especially the surgical treatment, started out with this man, William Nalder. So he was the one who proposed how to deal with most of these cancers, and he was a man who proposed a lot of radical surgeries. He went on improving surgeries, doing more and more mutilating surgeries like radical mastectomies and the four-quarter amputations. With him, it became synonymous that any cancer surgery is a mutilating radical surgery. But these things slowly changed, and I put in a little bit of history of this thing. Surgery remained as a central axis around which all other treatment, radiation, immunotherapy, and chemotherapy, targeted therapy, whatever the thing, revolved around it. And surgery remained the major component of all these treatments. But this scenario was changing. And nearly for 100 years, surgery dominated the field of cancer management, but it slowly changed. And right now, what we have is a multimodality treatment, where each and every treatment is only a component. There is no single treatment that can be called as a primary treatment, on others as adjuvant or neoadjuvant. But for practical reasons, we still consider the treatment that is delivered first, especially which has got the most curative potential, like surgery or radiotherapy as a primary treatment, and all other treatments as adjuvant or neoadjuvant. So if we go in a little bit into what does really by a neoadjuvant or adjuvant. Surgery, if you say consider it as a primary treatment, whatever therapy that is dealt before it is called as a neoadjuvant, and whatever therapy that is dealt even after surgery is called as adjuvant. What is exactly the benefit of all these things? See, what was traditionally considered as inoperable tumors or not suitable to take them for the first as a primary treatment, these neoadjuvant treatments can shrink these tumors and make them amenable for treatment. That's why we are more interested in all these neoadjuvant therapies. So as a general rule, very small tumors, we consider them for a direct surgery or concurrent chemoradiation as a first primary curative potential. And any advanced tumor, we take them up for neoadjuvant therapies, we shrink them and make them suitable for a surgery or radiation therapy. So what with this development of very effective neoadjuvant modality, what resulted was a lot of conservative surgeries, especially breast conservative surgeries, which have become quite popular these days. And nearly this is offered to nearly about 80% of our patients, but that's not the numbers we hear. We offer it to nearly about 10-20% of our patients. Most of our patients do not opt for such surgeries. But in other areas, especially the limb salvage procedures, it has become a reality. The neoadjuvant therapies have become very effective, and we hardly ever do amputations for most of the bone sarcomas or soft tissue sarcomas, and we can really salvage the limbs. And also mandible reconstructions and mandible preservation techniques have become very much a reality in this. So with the development of the neoadjuvant therapies, a new marker emerged, which is called as a pathological complete response. The pathological complete means that when we operate after a neoadjuvant therapy, there is no tumor found in the specimen. This is pathological. This is called as a pathological complete response. With the period of follow-up, they have found out that those people who have pathological complete response are long-term survivors. So are we looking at an era where we can avoid surgeries for all these patients? That is the question right now that's most important. And we probably are going into that area where we will be avoiding surgery for most of these cases where we have with the pathological complete response. But right now, we do not have surgery into that scenario. For one reason, there is no single investigation which can categorically say that this patient has got a pathological complete response. The moment all these PET CT scans, multiple corneal biopsies are nowhere nearer to proving that this patient has got a pathological complete response. By denying a patient who has got a microscopic residual disease a surgery, which is a proven modality, we are actually harming the patient than technician. So right now, we do not say that surgery can be taken away from the treatment of cancers. And surgery still forms the most important aspect of most of the solid tumors. So does it really mean that the role of surgery is shrinking? No. Actually, the role of surgery has become more because of this new adversary. What it has led to is, those tumors which was condemned to palliative treatment, these neoadjuvant strategies have shunned the tumors so much that actually a lot of newer supra-radical procedures have emerged. Some of these supra-radical procedures are multi-organ resections, metastatically, which was once considered as not at all a curative option, is now a reality. And a lot of peritonectomies for peritonectomies, the role of peritonectomies, the indications are expanding at a rapid rate. So these are some of the tumors for colorectal malignancies. The resection of colorectal secondaries is a reality today. There is no second thoughts about it. When we are dealing only with the liver alone secondaries, resect as much as possible. And survival data has emerged for resecting all these colorectal metastases. It has shown to have survival advantage. There is no second question about as far as liver resection for secondaries in colorectal malignancies. And obviously, we are expanding into other chain malignancies where the results are not as good as colorectal. But with more and more neoadjuvant and adjuvant strategies becoming stronger, these things will also become a reality. So these are pelvic excentrations, multi-organ resections where we remove the entire pelvic organs and reconstructions with the ileal and colonic nodules. Because of the development in anesthesia and post-operative care, all these techniques have become a reality. And these are peritonectomies with hyperthermic intraperitoneal chemotherapies. Obviously, all these metastatic peritoneal mice who are dying quite alarmingly and suffering in a lot. This HIPEC has made a reality to expand their lifestyle survival for nearly over 2 to 3 years. So all these data are now clear. So what has happened because of all these therapies? Today, cancer is to be considered as any other chronic disease. In fact, with the modern therapies, which are very prudentially used, it can give a survival which is even better than some of the chronic diseases which we know, like chronic renal failure, coronary artery disease, a lot of very bad diabetes, and all these things. Some of the tumors can actually have a better survival than all these chronic diseases. Not only that, the quality of life has dramatically improved with modern therapies. And really, we are looking at the, coming into an era where cancer should be actually be seen as a chronic disease rather than as a disease which is a killer disease. So the future, all modalities including the surgical procedures will continuously be redefined. And in the next 10 years, if I'm talking here, none of these procedures may exist, and we will be talking about newer procedures. That is the reality today. And more than that, what is emerging is the personalized cancer care, where each and every individual is going to have a different treatment based on their tumor characteristics and their genome. And this is becoming a reality. Even now, it is available. Therapy is little expensive, nearly about 2 lakhs or 3 lakhs to keep that. But we really don't know how effective it is. But the way the development is going on, this will be the future. Thank you.
Any questions, sir?
Sir, as far as the rectal cancer is concerned, we prefer a anterior radiotherapy for most of the tumors, except for a T2 and T2. Most of the presentation is late presentation, a locally advanced tumor. All these tumors, preoperative radiotherapy, concurrent radiotherapy with chemo and RT has become the standard. As far as colon is concerned, still surgery is the most preferred option as the first option. And there are only very few indications for radiotherapy in the colonic malignancies. Especially if there is a posterior wall invasion in the psoas or an anterior.
What I'm asking is, surgery alone is sufficient or we have to give chemotherapy?
Very, very early tumors, T1, N0, or even to a certain extent some T2, N0 tumors, probably surgery alone is sufficient. In all other tumors, you need to have adjuvant therapies.
No, adenocarcinoma generally don't respond to radiation.
No, sir. Not for rectum. Rectum, we have very good response to preoperative radiation. Maybe colonic tumors may not have a role, big role for radiation, but for rectal lesions, definitely.
Yeah.
I'm really concerned with the quality of life after such a surgery. I mean, you take out every part of the body, but I wonder really whether the quality of life will remain the same. I really wonder.